Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Camera Tuesday. In today's episode we're gonna take a look at another contender for mirrorless world, Fuji X-T3. So let's dive right into it. Now I have followed the same procedure. I have compiled a lot of reviews and I have provided some of the best one in the description below, and this is a basically summary of whatever we know so far. Now this is out, people have been using it, so you can be very confident in this review that if you understand this properly, you will get what you will understand everything that you need to know. So basically this is the only backside illuminated APS-C sensor. Now why does that matter? Well, backside illumination inherently makes sensors better by reducing what we call signal to noise ratio. So the better that ratio, the better image that is coming off of the sensor. Now of course after that there is a lot of processing, but if you get a very clean image in the first place from the sensor, the processing only makes it better. So having a backside illuminated sensor, it is very common for full frame, however nobody has done that for APS-C yet. So this is Fuji's big, you know, claim that we have the first backside illumination. It's not that it cannot be done, it's just that for an interchangeable for APS-C, this is the first. So this means compared to every other APS-C, this inherently has better signal to noise ratio, which means better low light performance, which means better dynamic range. So we have that. So very good sensor. Then we come to the fact that this company, as in Fujifilm, is the only company that can compete against Nikon and Canon in terms of color reproduction and beat it. The only people who can even come close to beating these guys are Leica cameras, which are, let's just say, $5,000 piece. So nobody is like, you know, really taking it seriously. However, these have, because Fujifilm used to make films, as in like actual negative rolls, they have very thorough understanding of color, you know, what we call color science. So they really show in this. So this camera, if you take it out on let's say journey and you are only on JPEG, you don't even bother with RAW, you on the JPEG and you shoot, 99% of the time you will be very happy what this camera will give out to you, basically ready to use. So if you are you know, in a scenario where you just want to enjoy the tour or trip or the, you know, thing that you are doing, this camera will really help you because the film output that they have is phenomenally awesome. And then we come to the fact that this camera itself, now its predecessor suffered with it had good autofocus but wasn't great. This has great autofocus. However, be mindful, because the lenses have been like, you know, existing in the lineup, older lenses work slowly. Now that's not the fault of the camera, that's the fault of the lens itself. That's like trying to Nikkor lenses in, you know, modern Nikon camera, flat out will work very slowly simply because it has screw drive you know, autofocus system, which is very slow. So before you jump into the fact that let's say you will get a Fuji camera and it has great autofocus, please check with the lens. Modern lenses, modern Fuji body, ultra awesome autofocus. This has really, really refined the autofocus. Now autofocus at this point is almost in par with Sony, Nikon and Canon. Now it's not as polished as those you know, big boys, but it is more like leaps and bounds ahead of Panasonic, leaps and bounds ahead of Nikon. So you will be very pleasantly surprised how accurate the autofocus system in this, and not to mention it's also very fast. Then we come to the aspect that why would you want to buy this rather than, like, let's say a camera like I have 800D or any other APS-C from you know, Nikon or Canon. One simple reason: this is actually compact. The lenses that are built for this are specifically built for APS-C. Fujifilm only makes APS-C and medium format, so their lenses don't have a bleed over, so their lenses is specifically built to maximize portability when we are talking about APS-C. So their lenses, even though kit lenses of this would be more or less the same size the kit lens of what you have for your Canon and Nikon, the size will be smaller because they are in like spending a lot of time to make sure this is compact. So if you hold this camera, if you would be surprised how compact this is, even with higher image quality, even with higher quality image sensor, even with better film reproduction, this really does feel compact. Like this is something you pull out on a street, nobody's gonna notice you. And this is personal preference, that you may enjoy this sort of filmy look, you may want, like, you know, DSLR feel, that's up to you. So be mindful of that, but it is compact. and this properly implements USB-C. Only Sony has done that, and not also not to mention not in every Sony camera it is properly implemented. But this has very good USB-C implementation, as in if you plug USB-C, they even validated one power bank also. So if you have that power bank and let's say you plugged it in, if you are using the camera, it will directly run on power bank. Once you stop using your camera, it will charge the battery. So phenomenal use of the system that it has. It's a compact camera. You can literally go anywhere while recharging the camera with the same charger that you have for your mobile phone. So this is very, very well implemented system. Not just okay, we have this, but it's very well implemented. And another example of that is that Fuji has a bit of a different battery grip environment than every other manufacturer, is that you keep the battery in the in camera, but on the bottom you put two extra batteries, so overall you end up with three batteries. And the way Fujifilm switches between, it does not deplete all of them parallelly, it depletes them serially. It's like once it will deplete your in-body battery, then it will deplete the body battery number one, then it will deplete the battery number two, but you will never notice it. It's like it won't go like okay, even though let's say while you're recording video, you're recording video and battery one goes down, it will seamlessly switch to battery two. You don't have to worry about it. So it's kind of interesting that you can get three battery active and using actively used in the battery grip. So it's kind of unique. However, people do say that battery should have been a bit bigger. It's good, under no circumstances is bad. It's just that it's not groundbreaking like Sony Z battery that they are introduced for Sony a7 III. So it's quite compact, and the lenses they have, it's kind of manual classic lenses. The lenses they are selling you have aperture ring also. So if you are like a photography nerd, like you actually want to make your photograph rather than like like you want to spend time, you want to like give it feeling, this camera will get you from your intention to output very quickly. You will be very happy with this camera. So all things considered, at this point, you can easily say this is the best APS-C camera in every regard. Like, of course, you can say like D500 can beat it in autofocus. Again, does not have USB charging and it's like a size of a tank. You can say like Sony A500 series, it's more or less the same cost, but has in-body image stabilization, but does not have the quality that these camera have. It's because of the sensor being BSI. Sony has BSI technology, but they have only used it for full frame. So at this point, as I talk to you, and these run around circles around Panasonic APS Micro Four Thirds system. You can check my video here where I specified like Micro Four Thirds should not have been created. Panasonic and Olympus should have simply got together and created a simple lens mount and used APS-C, because APS-C was mass produced, so their camera would have been cheaper and they would have stuck with that for much longer, because Fuji is no longer in a hurry to jump to full frame, but Panasonic already jumped into full frame. They had to, because Micro Four Thirds was already maxed out. They still have at least one generation left before they max this out. So it is the best APS-C system all around. Like everything combined, this is the best system. So is there a consequence? Yes. Now, the reason why I'm mentioning this in red, that it does not have flip out screen, is that it was removed from it. As in, there is a cheaper Fuji system, which is X-T100, and it has the same flip up, flip down screen, but it also flips out. It does not have the same rotation that you will get with Canon or Panasonic. It's a bit different, but it has it. So this kind of makes me worry, because that this sort of pattern is more or less same with Canon and Nikon, where they hold out features from low end so they can give it in the higher end model. That means that if you are waiting for budget option, this is really bad. Like they could have easily given flip out screen. That would have made that camera much more palatable to larger audience. They have it. It's not like I'm comparing something they don't have it. They have it. They have it even in cheaper cameras. So it makes no damn sense to omit it from this one. Now IBIS, I'm not that mad about it, because IBIS is a luxury feature. Like we are just so spoiled by it, but it is a luxury feature. No DSLR has it, and not to mention only few camera have proper IBIS, and you can buy optically image stabilized lens. So IBIS would have been nice, but you can live without it simply because lenses have optical image stabilization. However, flip out screen, you have to have it. You have to have flip out screen, especially if you have a light and compact camera, but you try to take a selfie, you can't do it. So this really frustrates me. And it has a recording limit, as in you can notice this has two SD cards. Be mindful, both of them are UHS-II, as in that card that has extra pin. And on top of that, you can see a remote port. Now the remote port is more or less like this, and it has the same 2.5mm pin. So I think you can easily connect your Canon remote with it. Third party remotes are available, so you don't have to spend too much money for it. So it has the technology, but it has that same problem with every other manufacturer. They're not willing to pay that extra tax that they have to pay in European Union. Only Panasonic is the one that did that, and benefit of that, Panasonic G series cameras, as in GH5, has no recording limit. It will only stop recording when it either overheats or runs out of memory or runs out of power. So this, even though it has the technology, it has two UHS-II and it has very good video features, as in like 10-bit internal recording. Be mindful, 10-bit is 420, not 422. So you can get 10-bit output from it in 422 if you are using HDMI system. So it's a very good camera, but the omission of flip-out screen kind of irks me, because I'm not that mad about IBUS, because I'm living without it. So, but a flip-out screen could have been added, given the fact that they know how to make flip-out screen on cheap. So this kind of irks me that they are like reserving this sort of feature for their higher end model, which is this is XT, there is XH1 series. So if that is the case, recommending this sort of camera is kind of tricky. I would simply say just wait and spend more money for the higher end model and be happy with that, because that model will come after this, have the same sensor, have the same technology, and have flip out screen, IBUS. So again, at that sort of scenario, this kind of makes this camera just a stopgap. Okay, for this year, this is our camera. Next year, we're gonna release another better camera. So if they have given a flip out screen, I would have been very happy, but without flip out screen, it's not that great. So should you go into Fuji? Like, Fuji is the greatest at this point for APS-C, and Fuji no longer have to worry about Micro Four Third or full frame, because Fuji is focused on one niche aspect. Fuji is no longer in a place where they have to like constantly compete in all front. Nobody is there to actually dethrone Fuji. But should you buy it? But be mindful, it is a very complete system. So before you jump into it, before you are like, okay, I'm gonna spend it, because it is relatively cheaper compared to GH5, please make sure that you will never regret the fact that you are now in APS-C. Because APS-C, while it is very good, while it is very legendary, it still does lack some aspects of full frame, as in the super large lens selection that you have, the super cheap lens selection you have, and low light performance is undeniably gorgeous. And if you need lenses like f1.8 for a APS-C to counteract f2.8 in a full frame, you have to make sure that do you have those lenses, f1.8. like Sigma used to make a 18-35 f1.8 APS-C lens, which will give you a very good depth of field in your APS-C, that will look more or less exactly like a full frame. So please check the lenses. Like, Fuji is awesome right now, but I would urge you, please look around the lenses, because A, there is not enough third-party lenses, so the cost of these lenses are not very cheap. So please look around, please be mindful, okay, what do I want? Do I want telephoto lenses? Do you think they have enough telephoto lenses? Do you think they have the enough telephoto lens with enough quality, with aperture? Like, do they have 72-300 f2.8 or f1.8 in this scenario for compensating? So please check the lens before you jump into Fuji system, because they don't have enough third party. Like Samyang does make some X mount lenses, but be mindful of this. And even though it's APS-C, it's not super cheap, not because the lens itself is expensive, because the low availability, as in how few of them are being manufactured, some places you will end up finding APS-C lenses for let's say Canon and Nikon to be very cheap compared to this, even with the same optical quality. So be mindful of this. This is a complete system. That's why you don't see everybody raving about Fuji, because A, their lens environment is not as complete as compared to Nikon or Canon. And not to mention, once you buy these lenses can't be used on full frame, not even in crop factor. So let's say I have this 18-55 f2.8, it's a crop factor lens. So can I put it in full frame? Yes, but I have to crop it, but I can still use it. Now I have a full frame lens that works on this, but there is no such flexibility here. So please check the lens before you buy and check the cost. So you might be like, okay, 72-300 it has, but you didn't check the price, and after buying it you're like, wait a minute, why the heck that lens is like $3,000. Please check the lens, price and availability, because it's not as common as a Nikon or Canon. So be mindful, this is a system. Once you jump in, you can't jump out. So this was my presentation on Fuji system. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. And if you didn't, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. And I would urge you to leave a comment what you wanna see in the next episode of Camera Tuesday. And please subscribe, press the bell icon if you are free. And as always, thanks for watching.